Hey, 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 it's Good Guy Jai, and I am coming at you now with the Terminal Challenges. This is for KringleCon 4, and they are just going to be more summaries of the challenges and how I solved them condensed into one video. The first one is Terminal 1, which is EXIF metadata. You have to look at file metadata using EXIF tool and find one that's been modified. I used EXIF tool and wildcard for star.docx and then grep for modify. I then did the same thing and grepped for tac A5 modified to give me 5 lines after it. In hindsight, I should have done that as tac B because I got some wrong answers submitting until I realized it had to be the file that was one off of what I had. So close yet so far. Alright, Terminal 2 is grepping for gold. Now, you follow along with what you're being asked and you chain together grep commands on bigscan.gnmap, which is a grepable nmap file. For question 1, you just grep for the IP. For question 2, you just grep for the IP. Honestly, challenges are hard. For question 3, you grep for up and pipe it to WCTACL. That'll get you the count and then you're done. For question 4, there's a few ways that you can go about it. They solved it by essentially doing an expression, a regular expression, and piping that into a command. But I just grep for HTTP because, well, that solved the challenge too. For question 5, I grepped to count the number of hosts and pipe that to WCTACL. From there, I had to subtract a different grep command to the number of hosts with open ports. This gave me the number of hosts that didn't have open ports. For question 6, I had to grep to the number of filtered results, counting down from 100. So I actually did this a little bit sneakily, counted down from 100 until I got to 988. 987 didn't give me a result, so I knew that 988 was the most filtered ports. And because I knew that this was scanning 1,000 ports, this gave me 12 ports and the answer. For Terminal 3, the Logic Chompers, beating it on difficulty 3, essentially just play the game, but open up the console and look in the array on chompy.js. This array mapped the squares to if they were true or not, which made the game easy. All you had to do was look at the answers in this script. The Terminal 4, you know what, let's call it Terminal 3.5 because it's not actually a terminal, so it's called Terminal 3.5, deal with it. It's the Frostivator. You can kind of fumble around moving the logic gates around until you get it, but it does give you an introduction to logic gates, so you can kind of plan ahead where they need to go. Heck, you could even print them off and look at them and look at how the power would pan out. You could probably even get a virtual one online that allows you to actually try them out. I don't know. You can kind of fumble around when you get the idea of how they work, though. For Terminal 4, you have an IPv6 Candy Striper challenge. Chris Elgi, if I pronounced that wrong, has some great snippets for interacting with IPv6 using common tools like curl, netcat, nmap, and ping. So using nmap, you just find the hosts and ports using the IPv6 protocol. Using curl, you hit a web service, and then the web service tells you to connect to another open TCP port to get the activation phrase. So you do that and the phrase is peace on earth. Terminal solved. For Terminal 5, it's the Holiday Hero Challenge. So I originally succeeded on 2-player, but if you didn't already watch the Shellcode Primer video, it didn't count as succeeding. Anyway, yeah, I did go back before the submission date and completed it in 1-player by enabling 1-player in both local session cookie and JavaScript. Basically, you just had to first enable it in your local session cookie and then reload the iframe that it's presented to and then run the JavaScript command and it would say, yeah, no worries, you're in 1-player. And player 2, the AI, yeah, it's pretty good. Nice one. Terminal 6 is the YARA rules. This took a little bit longer to complete and could almost be considered an objective. I had to use XXD and pipe it to a tac C20 to make it a count of 20 and then do a tac P so it's sort of all concatenated and outputted nice. And then I piped in the application that we had here and I just named it like new application. And I used sed and I replaced the raw hex values. So I piped it to sed and replaced the raw hex string with what I wanted to replace it with. That allowed me to modify the binary without actually having to cause any kind of issues. And then I'd try to run it, and I'd get a Yara rule that it hit on. And so then I used a combination of grep for sort of 20 lines after the relevant rule number to find out what it was matching on. And then I would replace those values using the same XXD method. I repeated it until I got to rule 1732, and there was a lot of strings here, but the easy win is that it needs to be less than 50 kilobytes. So I piped a bunch of A characters and appended that to bloat it past 50 kilobytes, and I just ignored the rest. Terminal 7 is strace, ltrace, or retrace, and you have to use strace or ltrace to essentially debug a Linux binary. In the end, strace allowed me to find out that registration.json was missing, and ltrace helped me to find the exact contents that needed to be in registration.json. In hindsight, a simple ltrace command in the binary would tell me everything I need to know. For Terminal 8, it's IMDS exploration, and it really is the precursor to Objective 10. Without it, you really can't necessarily succeed at Objective 10, unless you already know about it. While you're in here, flush the toilet just for a bit of fun. You have to collect candies by following Noxious O'Doctor. Honestly, it's not a lot more required except reading. It is pretty much a tutorial on IMDS. For Terminal 9, it's the Ho-Ho-No challenge, and it opens Objective 8. I spent way too much time on it, to be honest, because one of my files didn't have a .conf extension, and then I got lost. However, the aim was to create a fail-to-ban filter for a log file, so first I had to take a look over the log and find anything that looks like any kind of error or attack. There were four different entries that were unique fields that needed to be in there. I had to create three files for this, a filter, a jail, and an action, all of which needed that .conf extension. It wound up looking a little bit like what's on screen at the moment, and I had to restart the fail-to-ban service before running the naughty list refresh or else it wouldn't work. But at the end of the day, success. For Terminal 10, it's the ELF code exploration. This was similar to last year's challenge, except using Python 3, and it had some changes with how you interact with the elves and the levers. You need to make the elves traverse the tracks, and honestly, I took last year's answers that I came up with and modified them to work within the premise of Python 3. I guess sort of like self-plagiarism, except I'm citing myself, so yeah, let's roll with that. I took a little bit of time, but at the end of the day, it wasn't too difficult if you have a reference point to work with. For Terminal 11, this is sort of a bit of a bonus, and I'm combining these terminals into one, Terminal 11 and Terminal 12. This is the log for Jack, and they were added after Christmas and not actually part of the KringleCon challenge. You essentially can follow along and learn about the log4j vulnerability and how it works. From a defender's point of view, you have to find evidence of exploitation and a way of locating vulnerable instances on systems and just try it out without actually exploiting it in a malicious fashion. From an attacker's side, you have to exploit it and get a reverse shell to read the contents of a file. It's not part of the KringleCon challenge, but it is a good learning opportunity nonetheless, which came out after Christmas. And with that, that's all the terminal challenges completed.